No war can come into our world, Ashley. Whatever comes, I'll love you just as I do now, until I die.
The first time I was aware of Olivia de Havilland, I was 10 years old. I was sitting in a movie theater in Longview, Washington, and there was Olivia de Havilland in Gone with the Wind up on that screen, confined to a rain-drenched wagon, holding a newborn baby, and trying to protect that baby from a storm raging around them, while also hiding from unfriendly Yankees patrolling the area. Well, the look on Olivia's face in that scene, a mix of physical pain, emotional fear, and great concern for the baby she's holding, is an image that I've never forgotten. I mean, I was hooked at that moment, and I've been a fan of hers ever since. After that, everything I saw or read about Olivia de Havilland impressed me more. Among them, her courageous lawsuit against her employers at Warner Brothers in 1943, something which would have been career suicide for her if she'd lost that suit and kept her off screen and without a paycheck for 3 years. But a case she won and is now in the law books as the de Havilland decision, which severely limits studios' control over their contract actors. She fought for that for one basic reason. She felt it was the right thing to do. Well, then came a wagon full of Oscar nominations for Olivia. Besides one for Gone with the Wind in 1939, there were additional nominations for Hold Back the Dawn in 1941, and The Snake Pit in 1948. The Snake Pit, a particularly challenging role addressing a very difficult issue, that of mental illness, and she is terrific in it. Particularly because so much of her performance has to do with her hearing things in her mind. I mean, you swear she's just sitting alone on a bench, hearing things only she can hear. Yet the truth is, there was a crew of 75 people watching everything she's doing.
Did you sleep well last night, Mrs. Cunningham? How are you today?
Very well, thank you. Who is he? And why all those questions? As if he were testing me.
Do you hear voices?
You think I'm deaf? Of course I hear yours. It's hard to keep on being civil when they ask you such naive questions.
And she's lost in this world, and she's not afraid to act a part that's very difficult to do. It's quite extraordinary. Plus, she went home with the Best Actress trophy for To Each His Own in 1946 and The Heiress in 1949.
Think of it. I may never stand in this window again. I may never see Washington Square on a windy April night. Why won't you? Because I will never be in this house again.
Nonsense. You and Austin will be reconciled within the year.
I will never see him again in my life.
For over 50 years, Olivia charmed audiences in movies, including the 9 that she made with Errol Flynn, like Captain Blood and The Adventures of Robin Hood, which made the two of them one of the great screen teams.
You remember that day in Sherwood Forest? I realized then, for the first time, that what you were doing was right and that we were wrong. Now let me finish. You taught me then that England is bigger than just Normans and Saxons fighting and hating each other, that it belongs to all of us to live peacefully together, loyal only to Richard and to England.
Bottom line, the more I read about this extraordinary actress and studied her work, the more I admired her. Also admired the fact that she had a very strong personal life that extended far beyond her celebrated career. Strong family ties, including a son and daughter she's always adored. I must admit, knowing Olivia has changed the course of my life. We first met on February 26, 1977, when she was in Los Angeles filming Airport 77. It's an interview which was supposed to last an hour, but turned into a lively 3-hour visit, punctuated by several bottles of champagne. And from there, a friendship began which endures to this day, 40 years later. Rarely does a Sunday go by that we don't talk on the phone. Olivia in Paris, me either in New York or California. We've traveled to some exotic locales together, and more importantly, we've laughed a great deal together, Olivia being one of the wittiest women I've ever met. Her great sense of fun being only one of the many assets she possesses as a human being. Something she said to Errol Flynn the first day they met says a great deal about Olivia de Havilland. While they were waiting to test for the leads in 1935's Captain Blood, she asked Errol Flynn casually what he wanted out of being an actor. He said, as if her question surprised him, "Well, I want success. What is it you want out of all of this?" It took her a moment to think about that, and then she said, "I want respect. Respect for doing a difficult job at making it look easy." And then she later said to me, "You know, both Errol and I were very lucky. We each got what we wanted." One of the many great gifts I've been given has been the chance to know this extraordinary lady. It's why I celebrate February 26th as a pivotal day in my life. That's the day we first met, a gift for which I'll always be forever grateful. For Turner Classic Movies, I'm Robert Osborne.